In the last lesson, you built this user interface, but in order to handle taps on this button to change the cards up top, we're going to need a little bit of Swift code. By the end of this lesson, you'll be writing your own Swift code statements, and you'll realize that it's not so hard to read or write, so please watch until the end. All right, let's buckle up and let's go. First of all, let's make sure we're all on the same page. What is coding? Well, to me, it is just the act of writing out code statements which represent instructions that we want the computer to do. And then the computer reads the code statements and carries out our instructions. Well, what is Swift then? Well, Swift is the coding language that we use to write those code statements. Just like a language, for instance, English or Spanish has a structure and it has rules to follow and it allows us to express ourselves, the Swift coding language is the same. It has a structure and a grammar which we follow in order to write Swift code statements. These Swift code statements are then converted into machine code, which the computer can understand and carry out. Now you might ask, why not just write machine code and skip this extra step? Well, Swift code is easy to read, write, and to manage for us human beings, but machine code is not. So that's why we need this step. Now the thing that converts the high-level code, like Swift code, to machine code is called a compiler. In this case, with building iOS apps, Xcode performs this compilation step. Now that you understand what it is, let's try writing some Swift code statements of our own. And I know the perfect place to do this. We're going to experiment with some Swift code in something called Xcode Playgrounds. Now, if you're brand new to this video series, we downloaded and installed Xcode back in lesson one. So if you don't have Xcode ready yet, just go ahead and watch lesson one right over there and come back to this lesson when you have Xcode ready to go. Now, a playground is a lightweight way for us to practice with and experiment with Swift code without creating a brand new app project, which has a ton of views already set up for you and things that we don't need. So here's how we can create our playground. Make sure that Xcode is in focus. You can click on Xcode dialog window right here, go up to File, and then go New and choose Playground. You're going to get something like this. Now we are going to go under iOS and we're going to choose blank. And that's going to be the most basic of basic playgrounds for us to test our code with. Click on next and we are going to save this somewhere. I'm just going to call this Swift code playground. You can call it whatever you'd like. We're just going to use it to test some code. Okay, so now, first of all, I'm going to close this left-hand navigator because we don't need that by clicking that button. And then I'm going to make this window a little larger so we can see what we're working with. Okay, so if you're following along, you should have something that looks like this. Now in this brand new playground, we have this single Swift statement. You can ignore the import statement for now. Let's focus on this line of Swift code and let's see what that does. Var greeting equals hello playground. Let's dissect this Swift statement. First of all, we're going to talk about this hello playground part on the right hand side of the statement. Now this is a piece of text data and you've seen this before. In the user interface that you've previously built, I've highlighted the pieces of text data here. Now it shouldn't really surprise you. Apps are all about manipulating data, pulling data from various sources, manipulating that data, showing that data to users through the app user interface, interacting, capturing user interaction as data, and then processing that, storing data and retrieving data to and from databases, and so on and so forth. Later on in this lesson, we're going to talk about different types of data that you can work with. But for now, let's go back to the code statement. This is a piece of text data. I want to ask you a question. Where does this piece of text data live? Or in other words, where does it exist? Well, it exists in the computer's memory. This is memory space that is allocated for our app to function. Okay, great. Now, how do we refer to this piece of data in the memory so that we can work with it and manipulate it? So walk with me through this scenario. Imagine you have your first Swift code statement that creates this piece of data in the computer's memory. In your second Swift code statement, let's say you want to work with this piece of data. Perhaps you want to manipulate that text data, change it to all capitals, or maybe you want to take it to display it on the user interface or something like that. But how do you retrieve it and access it from the computer's memory? We need some way to be able to access and reference that piece of data in memory. And this is where the rest of that Swift code statement comes in. Let's go back to it. This is a variable, and it is something that allows us to keep a reference to something else. Think about it like a sticky label that you can stick on a piece of data. In this case, our variable, or label if you want to think about it that way, is called greeting. And the equal sign is what is called an assignment operator. Now, its job is to assign the data on the right-hand side to the variable on the left-hand side. It's like the process of sticking that label onto that piece of data. Right here, var is a special Swift keyword, and what it does is create a new variable. So if you read this entire Swift code statement from left to right, these are the instructions it would be giving to the computer when the computer executes it. So starting from the left, first of all, create a variable named greeting. Next, assign to this variable the piece of text data, hello playground. Now, after this code statement is run, we now have a way to refer to that piece of text data in memory. Anytime we want to get access to it, we just have to use the variable name. In this case, that is greeting. In fact, take a look at this second line. This code statement prints out the text data. Let's see how we can try this out on the playground. The Xcode Playground has a way for us to run or execute the code to see what the results are or the output. So here in the lower left-hand corner, you'll find this small play button. And if you tap on that, it's going to execute the playground. Now, the first time you tap on it, you can check the status bar. It'll tell you it's running. And after you click it, you're going to see the output. Now, right here, you won't see anything aside from something appearing over there because we haven't printed anything out. But in the lower right-hand corner, you see this other button. This brings up this little window down here, and this is called the console area. This is where output will happen. So let's go ahead and write that second print statement and try out printing out our variable. So I'm going to type in print, open bracket, greeting. Remember, this variable is going to reference hello playground. So let me hit stop here and hit execute again. And this time it's going to run both lines of code starting from line 3 and then line 4. And you're going to see the result of line 4 printing out the text data into the console here. Now I want you to notice something. In line 3, we had the var keyword, but then in line 4, when we wanted to use that variable, we did not have to use the var keyword again, because remember, this var keyword is a special Swift keyword to create a new variable. In line 4, we're not creating a new variable. We are simply calling it and using the data that it references. That's why we don't use the var keyword there. Now, if you want to use proper terminology, this process of using the var keyword to create a new variable is actually called declaring a new variable. Now, I only use the word creating because in my experience teaching this, creating makes more sense to beginners. But now that I've explained this to you, I'm going to start using the word declaring just so that in the future, if you learn from different other training materials, you won't get confused when you see them saying declaring. Now I want to show you something cool about variables. Remember that analogy about the variable being like a label that you can stick on data? Well, just like labels, how you can peel it off something and stick it on something else, you can do the same thing with variables. So in fact, I can assign something else to my variable. So let me reference the variable like that. Notice I don't have to use var again because I only need to create it once at the very beginning. So greeting, I'm going to use the assignment operator, and I am going to assign another piece of data, a different piece of data to it. Like that. Now, if I moved my print statement, so let me command X to cut it, paste it here, command V. Now, if I do that, what do you think this is going to print out? Let's go ahead and try it out. So I'm going to hit stop and then hit run. And it prints out, I can write Swift, because this has now assigned to my greeting variable the piece of text data, I can write Swift. Now, what happens to the first piece of text data, Hello Playground? Well, the computer will detect if nothing else needs to use that piece of data, it's going to clear it out from memory. Now, I mentioned before that there are different types of data that you can work with, so here is a list. Now, it's not exhaustive, but these are the most common and basic data types that you will begin working with. So first of all, let's talk about the string data type. This is what we've been working with so far. It's text data. I know that's a little bit of a weird term, but think of it as a string of characters. And in fact, this is the terminology for text data across most programming languages. So when you hear string, think of text. Next up, we have int and double. So int represents integer data. So those are like whole numbers, including negatives. And doubles are decimal numbers or fractional numbers. Boolean, or bool for short, stands for true, false, that type of thing. This data type is useful when there are only two options, like a light switch on or off. Now let's go into our playground and let's try out some of these data types. All right, so first of all, let's try out the numbers because we already did strings. Like this is a string right here. So that's text data. So let's try out an int. 5. We'll print out my int. Notice I'm using the var keyword to create a brand new variable called my int, and I'm assigning to it the integer 5. And then I'm printing that. Let's see what we get in the console window. So we get that 5. All right, let's try to look at my double. I'm just going to create the Boolean too. Now you'll notice as I'm typing, autocomplete pops up. And this is something in Xcode that helps you. Xcode can detect what sort of variables you have. And as you're typing, as I'm typing my, I can narrow down, it narrows down the list to some possible selections. And I don't have to type out the rest of it. I can just move down, press enter, and there we go. So let's go ahead and execute this, run this, and see what we get. All right, so there's our string data, there's our integer data, there's our double data, and there is our Boolean data. So the just in case you didn't know, that is going to be the flip side of false. It's just going to be true. All right, next up, now that you know about data types, I need to mention that when you declare a new variable, you also need to specify what data type it is going to be referencing. Now you might be saying, that's not true. Here's the thing, we've been using a short form to declare these variables right here. Here is the actual way. After the variable name, you put a colon followed by the data type that is to be expected that this variable will be referencing, whether that's string, int, double, bool, or something else. Now here's the kicker, variables can only store data of the same type that you declared for that variable. Now you might be thinking, looking at this playground, where have I declared any data types in these variable declarations? None of them have that colon data type. Well, what's happening here is a shorthand. I don't have to say what type of data it'll hold, but the system will look at what type of data I'm assigning to it, and then it's going to know, oh, okay, so this greeting variable is actually a string data type variable. This my int, it looks at this data that I'm assigning to it for the very first time, and it's going to know, oh, this is an int data type variable. So the same thing goes for the other variables. This is going to be a double. This is going to be bool. Now, why is this important to know? Well, let me show you an example. For this variable greeting, it is of the string data type, so I can assign these two pieces of string to it. In fact, I can reassign another piece of text data to it. However, let's say I try to assign an integer to it. We're going to, if we try to run this, we're going to get an error. Cannot assign value of type int, which is this, to type string, which is the greeting. Now, even if we do not declare the data type up here, so let me just get rid of that and let me run it again. it will still end up with the same error. Because the first time you assign data to that variable, you're locking in the type. It's gonna look at this and it's gonna say, this is string data type. This is going to be a string data type variable. And that's what it is from that point on. Okay, so that's just something that is important to know. Now, one last thing I wanna show you before we move on from this lesson is something called a constant. Now, constants are a special type of variable. Instead of using the var keyword to declare a new variable, we use the let keyword to declare a new constant. Now, everything about a constant is the same as a variable, from how it's used to how it's declared and how it can only store data of the same data type as what you declare it with. Now, the only difference, there's one single difference, and that is that with a constant, you cannot reassign data to it. Once you assign data to it, it is constant, all right? You're guaranteed that that is the piece of data that it's affixed to. Think of it as like a label, but instead of just sticking it on the piece of data, you are super gluing it on with some industrial grade stuff and you cannot rip it off, okay? That is like a constant. So let's go back to the playground and let's try this out. So for example, if I change this var for the greeting variable to a let, that changes it to a constant, we're gonna get an error here because we cannot assign a value. Greeting is a let constant. We've already assigned it this value, so we cannot reassign it. However, if I change my int to a let constant, this is going to be perfectly fine. I can run this and it's gonna produce output. However, if I try to reassign something to that label, let's say 40, we are going to get an error. Now you might wonder, why would we ever want to use a let instead of a var? Well, the reason is that variables have special allowances in memory, some stuff under the hood that gives us this flexibility, but it comes at the cost of not being as efficient or optimized as a constant. So if you know something is not going to change, or you want the assurance that it will never change as you are using your constant, then you should use the let keyword. And in fact, Xcode will help you optimize this. If you use var keywords and Xcode detects that, hey, you've never reassigned anything into this variable, why not use a let? And it's going to prompt you as you're coding in an actual app project, it's gonna prompt you, why don't you change this var to a let instead? Because it's not gonna impact anything. And in fact, under the hood, there's going to be a teensy bit of optimization.
Congrats on writing your first Swift code statements. If you're learning a lot from this video series, please support me by giving this video a thumbs up. And if you're not shy, please drop a comment below and let me know whether or not you are able to follow along. This diagram sums up what you've learned today. You learned about what variables are, how to declare them, and how to use them. You learned about data types, and finally, you also learned about constants. Great progress today. We are going to continue learning Swift, and we're getting closer and closer to going back to that war card game and adding user interaction. In this lesson, you learned about code statements. In the next lesson, we're going to learn how to batch these code statements up so that we can execute them as a group, so that we can assign that group to the button tap on the war card game. And that is how we are making our way towards adding interactivity to that war card game. Click over here to go to the next lesson, and I'll see you there.